A group of city hackers started a project called KleineAnfragen.de. This website aggregates all parliamentary inquiries in one place. But they didn't just put them all on one website. They scraped and passed all the PDF documents, put them with Grammar OCR, they indexed the files and made them fully searchable. And made the documents based on its contents and the ministries answering the request. This is what the website looks like. KleineAnfragen has made it easy to find information and a breeze to browse through this information. And since the start of the project in late 2015, over 43,000 inquiries have been published on the platform. So this is what such an inquiry looks like. You can see the document with some major information like the filing target, the release date, etc. It's really easy to link to. So it's a great transparency tool for journalists and citizens. But not only for them. Even the government is using KleineAnfragen.de to speed up their workflow. And here's the proof. In a report put together by the research department of the federal parliament, we found this link. We found the KleineAnfragen attributed as a source and link to. And we only found this by chance while we were scraping other documents from the research department. And we were hoping to see that the government is using this tool internally. Also, MPs are using the tool. They or their staff can subscribe to individual search terms and get updates via RSS or email every time there is an update to their query. So MPs would, for example, subscribe to their name, and whenever there is an inquiry with their name, they receive an email and an RSS. In a nutshell, KleineAnfragen is a tool for the civic tech community built by volunteers in their spare time that benefits the public, journalists, and the government alike. Our next example comes from Mexico. This one is about improving the procurement process. And as we all know, in a lot of countries, procurement is broken. This example taps into what Felipe mentioned earlier today. The civic tech community has to move into new spaces, like policy, to influence government processes and laws. Hack the system not only with code. So let me tell you a little story. In 2013, the Mexican government commissioned an iPhone application for its MPs. So far, so good, nothing special, lots of governments are commissioning iPhone applications. However, there was a flaw. The allotted budget for the winning contract was $7.5 million. For an app that has maybe a few hundred users, that's an incredible amount of money, and it's tax money. And the people over in Codera, Mexico, that's a community group of civic hackers in Mexico, reacted like this. But what's great about this example, instead of complaining, they figured that they could do better. So they put out a call to the community, whose goal it was to build the same app with just 0.01% of the original budget. And an iPad mini on top of that. And their call was heard. Within only 10 days, they got 6 working prototypes made, as well as a lot of media attention. The buzz was big enough that they got invited to present their projects in Parliament. While the original contract still went through, they couldn't stop that from happening, Codeando did not let it stop them. Together with the government, they set up a program for the latest inquiries, a program to fix the procurement process for software solutions, especially addressing small startups and companies. Redes Públicos, Public Challenges, streamlines the procurement process and makes bidding to government contracts available to small companies. Its goal is to encourage more startups and small companies to build tech for government. Redes Públicos focuses on modern software methodologies and open source, thus helping the government to realize better software products. This is what the website looks like. So far, there have been 50 challenges involving over 1,500 participants, and 7 prototypes have been developed into full-fledged products. For the program, Redes Públicos, they follow a 5-step process, and I'll quickly run through the 5-step process. It all starts with an open call for proposals by the platform, in which government partners describe what they are seeking to solve, what they are trying to achieve with their tech goal. And this first step is already marks already a huge difference from the usual procurement process, where it's common to publish tech specifications rather than the underlying challenges. The next step, ideas get submitted. And from all the submissions, 5 finalists are selected. And those finalists have to develop open source prototypes. They are getting money for those open source prototypes, so they are not developing it in their spare time. They are supported by the government. And from those 5 prototypes, the government agency chooses one who wins the contract, and to that goes the tech solution. A really great new approach to procurement that especially reaches small startups and companies. But as with every innovative concept, not everything went smoothly at the beginning, and Codeandro had unexpected issues. I think it's really important to share these learnings. That's why I'm sharing 2 issues they had with you. For one thing,
the financial resources were not there when they were needed. This was due to government budgeting cycles, which are yearly and did not fit this fast-paced prototype development. Unlike big companies with healthy cash flows, small startups do usually not have the resources to bridge payment gaps. So for them, getting paid a year late can mean the end of their business. Another issue was that the ministries were not ready to adapt to the new model. The internal processes stayed the same, which meant that contracting took way longer than hoped. And a lack of experience with startup-style project management created communication barriers between all the parties. Still, Regus Publicus is an impressive achievement. Making innovation happen within this rigid space of procurement is a major milestone for the civic tech community and an inspiration for me personally.
This is why, together with the German Federal Ministry of Education and Research, we at the Open Knowledge Foundation set out to find new concepts that help create better tools to empower citizens and to improve transparency. So we took the learnings from an Anzeigen, from the Regus Publicus project, as well as the Knight Foundation and their innovation grants to create new programs. We aren't as ambitious as the folks in Mexico. We're not setting out to change procurement in Germany because that could take us decades. We started with a more lightweight approach. Something that might also be interesting for Taiwan. We created a prototype fund for civic tech. So going with the theme of rapid prototyping, we bring together iterative software development and public innovation funding. This means that in the next 3 years, we will fund 40 projects with 30,000 euros each. So we're giving out a total of 1.2 million euros to civic hackers, entrepreneurs, individuals, and MacGyvers of all kinds. In the past, access to this public funding, to this public money, was exclusive to big research institutions and companies. Now, everybody with a good idea and the skills to execute can apply for funding. Our goal is similar to the goal of the Regus Publicus. We want to encourage more people to build software for government. A lot of civic tech tools are developed by volunteers, which is great, but it also means that a lot of civic tech tools are side projects. With the funds, we will give developers the opportunity to focus on their projects and to not have to worry about money. To reach the civic tech community, we had to hack the traditional public funding system. We had to adapt the system to the needs of civic hackers. This means we had to slim down the application process. I don't know what it's like in Taiwan, but the usual process to access public funding in Germany includes writing 40, 50, 60 page proposals. I've done it once, and believe me, you don't want to do that. So we hacked the system and found workarounds so that applicants only have to submit a single page explaining their idea.
One requirement, and that's very important, of the fund is that every project has to be free software, because we believe in openness and shared knowledge. I'm delighted to announce that the prototype fund is going to launch this July. We're preparing everything right now as we're as I'm speaking here, basically. And yeah, to wrap it all up, what can we learn from all of these projects? Kleine Anfragen has shown us that it's crucial to have access to government data if you want to build on top of it. I know too many projects where 80% of the work is spent on finding, scraping, cleaning documents and data that should be accessible to the public already. So open data is key. From Rebus Publicus, we learned that rather than talking about rigid constructs and specifications, we should communicate the underlying problems and challenges. By doing so, this brings a wider variety of ideas and prototypes to the table. The work of Gobiando also shows us that it's important to reach out to communities beyond the civic tech space, and I really like the presentation before mine, reaching out to people who don't know what civic tech is, to entrepreneurs, to startups, to researchers, but also to ordinary citizens, to get more people into the space and to build more products. And the final one, what does the GovZero Summit that we're all here today show us? Is exemplifies the common thread in all these successful projects. We have to foster exchange between all stakeholders, be it civic hackers, government officials, politicians, entrepreneurs, or NGOs. And I'm happy to see that this exchange is already in full swing. I'm really looking forward to the next two talks and to the sessions tomorrow. Yeah, thank you for having me. I'm Julia, this is my Twitter and the part of the Open Knowledge Foundation. Thank you.